السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله على نعمة الإسلام وكفى بها نعمة. All praise and gratitude be to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala on His blessing of Islam, which suffices as a blessing. Yesterday we had completed up to ayat number 78 of Surah Al-Baqarah, and inshallah today we will be going from ayat number 79 to one ayat number 141, and then complete the first para. Now, yesterday the ayah that we left on was, it said that people are making assumptions about this book. They are making guesswork. The example of this would be, often you hear people say, well, he's a very good human being, but he doesn't say his prayers. It doesn't matter. Well, it does matter, because Quran says that these are your wishful thinkings. These are just your guessworks. Now, today the ayah that we are going to begin with, which is ayah number 79, Surah Al-Baqarah, it is actually warning the scholars. Is warning the scholars as to why they let this deen become kind of a hearsay. It's a guesswork, it's wishful thinking of people. And this is because what Quran says is the scholars are not doing their part. Hence the message to us is, before we begin, that please spread the right knowledge. The knowledge must be, if we say this is from Quran, it must be from Quran. If we say this isn't in Quran, it shouldn't be in Quran. So let's go to the first ayat, which is ayat number 79. فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. And woe to those who write the book with their hands and then say, this is from Allah, and that they may sell it for a paltry gain. So woe to them for what their hands have written, and woe to them for what they have earned. So Quran here mentions the dishonesty and greed of the scholars who palmed off their own writing for message of Allah and gained a little profit or maybe a little favor from people by distorting the word of Allah to earn money or to earn fame. And they say, the fire shall not touch us except for a number of days. Say, have you taken a promise from Allah? If so, Allah will never break his promise. Or do you ascribe to Allah what you do not know? Now here what Quran is telling us is, this is a very dangerous assumption. To assume, to be complacent that hellfire is just a temporary phenomenon, is just a fire, a weekend of fire, or maybe a long weekend, but not to last forever. And ultimately, we will be sent to paradise. This is not true, because in the next ayat, Quran says, "Bala man kasaba sayyatan fa ahatat bihi khatiyatuhu fa ulaika ashabun nar hum fiha khalidun." Certainly, whoever commits a single sin, certainly whoever commits a sin, and then his sin surrounds him, such will be inmates of fire, and they shall remain in it for forever. Hum fiha khalidun, which literally means forever. So Quran raises a very deep and a thought-provoking concept over here in this particular ayah. And this has powerful implication, because sometimes people, you know, casually say, he just does one sin. He just drinks. Rest is fine. He goes to the mosque. He sometimes offers his Jummah with Jamaat, etc. But what Quran is telling us is that if one sin is unchecked, and it can actually completely surround people. It's like a single virus. A single virus can be fatal for a human being. And that is if a person continues and persistently indulges in one sin, knowing that it is a sin and yet not coming out of it. And those who have faith and do righteous deeds, they shall be the inhabitants of paradise, and they shall remain in it forever. Now again, the story of Bani Israel and the reminder of the covenants with them. وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْكُمْ وَأَنتُم مُّعْرِضُونَ. And when we took a covenant from the children of Israel, worship no one but Allah, and do good to your parents and relatives and orphans and needy, and speak kindly to people, and maintain prayers and give zakat, you turned away except a few of you, and you were used to turning away. So Quran here highlights some of the basic fundamental promises. The first is between us and Allah, that we will not assign any partner with him. And then our covenant with the immediate community, that we will take care of the micro responsibilities. Because in societies and communities where there is honor, where there is kindness, and where there is goodness, these societies flourish. And if these go away, then in such societies you will see sin increase, crime increase due to broken homes, due to depression, and due to suicide. And when we took a pledge from you, you will not shed your own people's blood, and you will not expel your people from your home. You promised, and you were a witness. Now, a little background to this ayah. Before the advent of Islam, there were two tribes, Aus and Khizraj. They were two pagan tribes who were permanently at war, living in Medina, but they were permanently at war with each other, along with their Jewish allies. There were three Jewish tribes also who were living around Medina, the tribe of Banu Qaynuqa, Banu Nazir, and Banu Qurayza. Now, the Jews would kill Jews in alliance with the pagans. They would be aligned with either the Aus or the Khizraj, and then captives, when Jewish captives were brought to them, they would do a fundraiser to release them from with ransom. So they would raise ransom to release their captives. Hence, they ransomed their captives in obedience to the same law, but paid no regard to the same book on killing their own fellow and driving them out of their homes. And this really speaks of the double standard, which Quran actually highlights over here. Then you were killing your people and expelling a part of them from their homes, backing one another against in sin and aggression. And if they came to you as captives, you would ransom them, though their expulsion itself was forbidden. And the next part of this ayat is so important that I should read it. أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْدِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْدِ فَمَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ يَفْعَلُ ذَلِكَ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا خِزْيٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَى أَشَدِّ الْعَذَابِ وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. Then do you believe a part of the book and defy the another part? So what is the reward of those of you who do this except a disgrace in the life of this world? And on the day of resurrection, they shall return to a severest punishment, and Allah is not oblivious of what you do. So what Quran is saying over here is this selective application of deen, it will only end up in humiliation. There will be a payback in this world, which is in form of a humiliation. And then on the day of resurrection, the day of judgment, such people will return to a most severe punishment. Now this ayat is a warning for all of us. It's a warning for all of us that we cannot divide the commandments of Quran into bits and pieces, that we accept those that we like and we reject those that we do not like. They are the ones who brought the life of this world for the hereafter, so their punishment shall not be lightened, nor shall they be held. And then story of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. And certainly we gave Moses the book and followed him with the messengers. And we gave Jesus, the son of Mary, manifest proof and supported him with Holy Spirit. Is it not that whenever a messenger brought you that which was not to your liking, you acted arrogantly, so you would disbelieve some and kill some. And they say, our hearts are wrapped. Rather, Allah has cursed them for their disbelief, so few of them have faith. And when there came to them a book from Allah confirming that which is with them, the earlier they would pray for victory over pagans. So when there came to them that which they recognized, they disbelieved in it. So may the curse of Allah be on the disbelievers. Now here Quran is highlighting that before the advent of our Prophet the Jews were eagerly waiting for the arrival of a messenger whose coming had been prophesied in their own books. And that's the reason why they had migrated and settled around Medina. Now, with the advent of our Prophet ﷺ, they recognized our Prophet, but they rejected him since he was not from them. And this is what is called tribal prejudice. So they were waiting for a Prophet, not for the purpose of knowing truth or guidance, but for worldly purpose and for self-glorification and glorification of their tribe. Evil is that for which they have sold their soul by defying what Allah has sent down out of envy, that Allah should bestow His grace on any of His servant that He wishes. Thus they have earned the wrath upon wrath, and there is a humiliating punishment for the faithless. And when they are told, believe in what Allah has sent down, they say, we believe in what has been sent down to us, and they disbelieve what is besides us, though it is a truth confirming what is with them. Say, then why would you kill prophets of Allah before if you were indeed believers? Now here a question is being raised, and I'm sure this question would arise in your mind too. The Jews at the time of our Prophet did not take part in the killing of the prophets. It happened much earlier. But the rule that Quran describes over here is that if a group of people are committing wrong deeds, but they are approved because such deeds are performed by the others, we become a party to it. So if we approve the deeds of someone, which are wrong deeds, even if we are not taking part in it, we have become an equal party to it. So certainly Moses brought you manifest proof, and then you took up a calf in his absence. You were the wrongdoers. And when we took a covenant with you and raised the mountain above you, declaring, hold on with power to what we have given you, and listen, they said, we hear and disobey. And in their hearts had been imbibed the love of the calf due to their faithlessness. Say, evil is that which your belief bids you, if you are indeed believers. Say, if the abode in the hereafter with Allah were exclusively for you and not for other people, then long for death if you are indeed truthful. But they will not long for it ever because of what their hands have sent ahead, and Allah knows best the wrongdoers. Surely you will find the greediest for life of all people, even the idolaters, each one of them eager to live 1,000 years, though it would not deliver him from the punishment were he to live that long, and Allah sees best what they do. Say, whoever is the enemy of Jibreel should know that it is he who brought it down to your heart with the will of Allah, confirming what has been revealed before it, and a guidance and a good news for the faithful. Here Quran is highlighting the excuse that was made by Jews. They would deny our Prophet and the Quran, and they would denounce that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would choose Jibreel alayhi salam as an angel to send down this book, saying that Jibreel alayhi salam was their enemy, and branding him an angel of curse rather than an angel of blessing. So what Allah has to say on that in the next ayat: whoever is the enemy of Allah, his angels, his messengers, and Jibreel and Mikael, let him know that indeed Allah is the enemy of the faithless. We have certainly sent down clear signs to you, and no one defies them except the transgressors. Is it not that whenever they made covenants, a part of them would cast it away, rather a majority of them do not believe in it? And when there came to them a messenger from Allah confirming that which is with them, a part of those who were given the book cast the book of Allah behind their backs, as if they did not know that it is Allah's book. Ayat number 102, and they followed what the devils pursued during Suleiman's reign, and Suleiman did not turn faithless, but it was the devil who was faithless, teaching people magic, what was sent down to the two angels at Babylon, Harut and Marut, and they would not teach anyone without telling him, we are only a test, so do not be faithless. But they would learn from these two that with which they would cause split between man and his wife, though they could not harm anyone with it except with Allah's permission. And they would learn that which would harm them and bring them no benefit, though they certainly knew that anyone who buys it shall have no share in the hereafter. Surely evil is that for which they have sold their soul had they known. Now what Quran is actually teaching us over here is that when people's faith weakens, the faith is weakened in Allah, the faith weakens in this book, then in Quran instead, or any book, revealed book, instead being a book of guidance, it becomes a book of supernatural deeds. Sorcery becomes a flourishing trade. People learn magic to harm each other. Now, remember that magic is categorically banned in Islam. It's categorically forbidden in Islam. Going to an astrologer, going to a fortune teller, or someone who claims to possess jinn or can put magic spells, these are all forbidden. Also remember, as this ayat very clearly says, nothing can happen without the will of Allah. Remember that if magic itself was powerful, we would see no happiness in this world. We would see no wealthy people in this world. So generally magic is used. There are certain cases where magic does work, but it is used to create division between a man and a wife. And this is the greatest achievement of Shaitan. Because the soundness of human civilization depends upon the soundness of the family unit, and the foundation of which are laid by a man and his wife, a husband and a wife. And nothing can be worse than a person who strikes at these very foundation of structure which supports the society as a whole. Had they been faithful and feared Allah, the reward of Allah would have been better had they known. O you who have faith, do not say Raina, but say Unzurna, and listen, and there is a painful punishment for the faithless. Now, Quran is actually here pointing out to a social problem, and this social problem is that there are certain words which cause ambiguity in the minds of people, and such words, Quran says, don't use them. So the word Raina, it means I beg your pardon, excuse me, please repeat for us. And the word Raina, if it is distorted and it becomes Raina, which is, you know, you pronounce it in a different way, Raina, Raina, it actually becomes an offensive word. It means, oh shepherd, it's used like an insult. Now the Jews would come to the company of our Prophet ﷺ. They would sit in the majlis, and then to draw his attention and also to insult him, they would use this word, Raina. So the instructions have been given to Muslims by Quran, stop using this word. Don't use this word. And this is, I think, in our time, this is not so unusual in our time also. We have seen in our life also, there are words like gale, the words like fairy, words like rainbow. They've all become like a kind of an abuse, right? Although gay means happy, but we shouldn't really call someone and say, oh, he's very gay, meaning he's very happy, because this word has different meanings to it. So don't use it. There's nothing wrong with the word, but don't offend people by using words which have, you know, double meanings. Neither the disbelievers from among the people of the book nor the idolaters like that any good be showered on you from your Lord. But Allah singles out for His mercy whosoever He wishes, and Allah is a dispenser of mighty grace. For any words that we abrogate or remove from memories, we bring another which is better than it or similar to it. Do you not know that Allah has power over all things? Do you not know that to Allah belongs the kingdom of heavens and earth, and besides Allah, you do not have any guardian or any helper? Would you question your messenger as Moses was questioned formerly? Whoever changes faith for unfaith certainly strays away from the right path. Too much questioning is not really something desirable, and that's what Quran is actually telling us. It's all about, you know, hearing and being obedient. Many of the people of the book are eager to turn you into unbelievers after your faith out of their inner envy and after truth has become manifest for them. Yet excuse them and forgive them until Allah issues his commandment, and indeed Allah has power over all things. So first and foremost, even if people are nasty, even if people want to turn you away from it, what you should do, you should excuse them, forgive them, be kind to them. That's the instruction. But also Quran is also telling us over here is that, you know, they want to turn people away from faith. They want to turn people away from faith because of what? Because of their envy. So envy and jealousy are extremely destructive emotions. The first sin that was committed on this earth was because of envy. The first murder that was committed on this earth was of envy, because Habil killed Kabil only due to envy. Now there's a hadith where our Prophet ﷺ said that the one who has been given a ni'mat, there is someone who envies him. So anyone who has ni'mat, there will be always someone who envies him. And that's the reason why there is, you know, so much of emphasis on prayers, prayers that protect us from envy, prayers that protect us from evil eye, etc. Also the fact that hatred is a very destructive force. Sometimes hatred is useful when it is against someone who is committing a zulm, but under normal circumstances, human emotions must be controlled and channelized, particularly anger and hatred. Nothing useful, nothing lasting in this world has been created because of hatred and anger. Wa aqimus salata wa atubuz zakah wa ma tuqaddimu li anfusikum min khayrin tajiduhu indallah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. And maintain prayers and give zakat. And the good that you send ahead of yourself, you shall find it with Allah. And indeed, Allah sees best what you do. These are the practical things. That's what Quran is telling. These are the constructive work. This is where your time and energy should be spent. This is where your effort should do. Excel in good deeds rather than being worried about other things. And they say, no one shall enter paradise except the Jews or the Christians. Those are their false hope. Say, produce an evidence, should you be truthful. Bala man aslama wajhahu lillahi wa huwa muhsinun falahu ajruhu inda rabbihi wala khawfun alayhim wala hum yahzanun. And certainly whoever submits his will to Allah and is virtuous, he shall have a reward near his Lord, and they shall have no fear nor they shall grieve. So Quran says salvation is not taking following of a group. Salvation is not being part of a community. Salvation is not being part of a jamaat. It is in aslama. Bala man aslama. Certainly whoever submits, it's about total submission to Allah. It is about total obedience to Allah. What Allah wants us to do. Do ibadat in a most beautiful manner. With shock, with muhabbat, with khulus, with sincerity, with love, with longing. Make all your good deeds beautiful, not for yourself, but to delight Allah. And the Jews say the Christians stand on nothing, and the Christians say the Jews stand on nothing, though they follow the same book. So said those who had no knowledge, words similar to what they say. Allah will judge between them on the day of resurrection concerning that which they used to differ. This is a sign of ignorance. This is a sign of jihalat. This is a sign of being prejudiced, to think that no one except us is right. That no one knows more than I know. This is a sign of great ignorance. Who is more unjust than he who forbids this in Allah's masjid, that his name should be remembered, and strives to ruin them? It was not that they should enter them except in fear. For them there is nothing but disgrace in this world and awful torment in the hereafter. To Allah belongs the east and west. Therefore, wherever you turn, there is presence of Allah. Surely Allah is all-embracing, all-knowing. So Quran tells us Allah is not bound. Allah is not constrained. Allah is everywhere. This is His universe. So Muslims are not really worshippers of Kaaba. We are not bowing down to Kaaba. We are the worshippers of Kaaba. And they say, Allah has taken a son. Glory be to Him. Rather, to Him belongs whatever is in the heavens and the earth, and we are obedient to Him. The originator of heavens and earth, and when He decides a matter, He just says, be, and it is. Kun fayakun. Those who have knowledge say, why does not Allah speak to us or come to us aside? So said those who were before them, words similar to what they say. Alike are their hearts. And we have certainly made clear signs for people who have firm faith. So the test is to believe in Allah, who is the ghaib, who is the unseen. He's unseen, Allah is unseen, but He's obvious. He's evident with all the sound, all the signs that are around us. The creation, the creation of the universe, the habitable planet that we live in, so finely balanced. The laws are so finely balanced. And then the signs inside us. And then the faculties that Allah has given to us to reflect, to see, to ponder. Indeed, we have sent you with truth as a bearer of good news and as a warner. And you will not be questioned concerning the inmates of hell. Never will the Christians be pleased with you, never will the Jews be pleased with you, nor the Christians, unless you follow their way. Say indeed, it is the guidance of Allah which is the true guidance. And should you follow their desire, after knowledge has come to you, you shall have no guardian nor any helper. So Quran warns its followers that they should, that they, which means the Christians and the Jews, they will not be satisfied even if Muslims were to fully adopt their culture, their way of life, their language, their etiquettes, their dress, their celebration, their mourning. And why do we need to do that? What about our own identity? Just think about the identity. Why should we be ashamed of our identity? We have a heritage which goes back to Hazrat Adam alayhi salam. All the prophets that are there, that's our heritage. That's the group of all righteous people. الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابَ يَتْلُونَهُ حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ وَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. And those to whom we have given the book, they read it or they follow it as it ought to be followed. They have faith in it. And as for those who defy it, they are the ones who are the losers. Now, Quran actually highlights here that who is a true believer? This ayat is so important. Who is a true believer? This book is available, but we need to realize its value. We need to read it. We need to understand it. We need to follow it. We need to propagate it. We need to make it a pivotal point of our life. You know, people assume that respect and izzat of Quran is all iman is all about. We need to remember that just kissing this book and putting it in a high place and not turning your back to it. You know, this is not the only way to give izzat to Quran. Of course, we need to love this book. Of course, we need to respect this book. This is vital. But it's our actions and deeds that really determine whether we really have faith in this book or not. It is how much we put this book into action, into deed. That's what really determines. Do we have any doubts in this book? Do we consider this book to be just a book of dogma? Do we ask ourselves, does our life has any relationship with this book? Do we open this book to seek solution to the problems when we encounter problems? Returning to the children of Israel, O children of Israel, remember my blessings which I bestowed upon you, and that I gave you an advantage over all nations. And beware of the day when no soul shall self-compensate for other, nor shall any ransom be accepted from it, nor shall any intercession benefit them, nor shall they be helped. And when their Lord tested Ibrahim with a great commandment, and he fulfilled them, he said, I am making you imam of mankind. He said, and from my descendants, he said, my pledge does not extend to the unjust. So Quran reminds us of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. Now, interestingly, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam lived nearly about 4,500 years before us, 2000 BC. He was born in the city of Ur, which is in Mesopotamia. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam with great trials, with great tests. He faced a violent crowd after he had broken the gods in the temple. He faced a king who claimed to be God, and who argued with him in a very logical manner. We will see that argument later also. He faced the fire when he was punished to be thrown into fire. He faced it in very patiently. And then Allah told him to do hijrat. And he left the most cosmopolitan city of that time. And he did hijrat. And then finally, his Rab asked him to sacrifice his dear son, Hazrat Ismail alayhi salam, who was born when Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam was in real old age, some say nearly 80 years or 86 years. And without questioning, Allah's commandment came, go sacrifice your son, and without questioning, he agreed to do that. And because of all this obedience of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, that he was made imam, not for us, but for all the revealed religions. For Christians, for Muslims, for Jews, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi considered to be an imam. And when we made the house, a place of assembly and security and safety, and you made the standing place of Ibrahim a place of prayers, and we ordered Ibrahim and Ismail to purify my house for those who do tawaf and those who do itikaf and those who go down. So Haram, the place in Makkah, this is a place of peace. And it is a place of peace because it has been purified from all sin, from all shirk. And when Ibrahim said, my Lord, make this a secure town and provide its people with fruits, such of them. And as for him who is faithless, I will provide for him too for a short time, and then I will drive him towards the punishment of fire, and it is an evil destination. Now the next ayat is an ayat we really need to follow. وَإِذْ يَرْفُعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَاعِيلُ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. And when Ibrahim raised the foundation of the house with Ismail, they prayed, our Lord, accept it from us. Indeed, you are all hearing, all knowing. Now, Quran here highlights the character of Hazrat Ibrahim, the humility of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. So Hazrat Ibrahim and Hazrat Ismail alayhi salam, who is assisting Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam to build the house of Allah. And he is the chief architect, he is the chief builder. He is doing the greatest act. The greatest act of righteousness is building the house of Allah. And then he is praying to Allah, and he is not sure whether this act is even accepted with Allah. The message for us is, be in a state of humility, particularly after doing a good deed, so that we do not become self-righteous. There should be no complacency. There should be no conceit after we have done good deeds. The real thing is not our ability to do good deeds. The real thing is whether this will be acceptable by Allah or not. So it's not the ability, it is the acceptability that we need to be worried about. Further on, the prayer of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, O our Lord, make us submissive to you and raise from our progeny a nation submissive to you and show us our rights of worship and accept our repentance. Indeed, you are all relenting, all merciful. Rabbana wab'ath fihim rasulam minhum yatlu alayhim ayatika wa yu'allimuhum al-kitaba wal-hikmata wa yuzakkihim innaka antal azizul hakim. Our Lord, raise amongst you from among them who should recite to them your signs and teach them of the book and wisdom and purify them. Indeed, you are the Almighty, the All-Wise. So this is a prayer of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, which is answered in form of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam coming over here as a messenger from among his people. So Quran here provides us with a guide that what do we need to do for the revival and resurgence of Islam. First, Rabbana wab'ath fihim rasulam minhum yatlu alayhim ayatika. That first thing he must recite to you from the revelation. The first is reading. You know, sometimes people question that if he should be only keep reading in Arabic without even understanding it throughout our life, not understanding the word, just keep reading in Arabic. The other view is, should we just not read Arabic at all and only look at what the translation of this book is? Well, I think the reality is somewhere in between. Both are important. We need to read the Arabic text because these are the words of Allah. What could be more sacred than the real words of Allah in Arabic? And then for guidance, we need to understand. So we need to understand the meaning. So this tilawat means both. We can only follow something which we can understand. So the second thing about tilawat is it's not just about reading, it's also about understanding. It's all, and only if you understand, you would follow. But it's not just the words. It's not just, that's not the aim. Taleem is actually teaching the next stage. Like companions knew Arabic. They all knew Arabic. They understood Quran. But for Taleem, it was a prophet was sent to them. Our Prophet ﷺ came to them as a teacher. So for this, for learning this book, it's always necessary. It's always necessary to have a teacher. This is mandatory. Because just knowing the meanings of Arabic words, that's not enough. Knowing Arabic doesn't mean the person will know Quran. It's like saying, if you know English, it doesn't mean that you can become a doctor. It doesn't mean you can become an engineer. We need a teacher. If knowing a language was enough, for learning a particular profession, there was no need for so many universities and colleges. There was no need for teacher. People would have just picked up, a book and became a doctor. Our Prophet ﷺ in a hadith said, "Surely I have been sent as a mu'allim. I've been sent as a teacher." So this book needs a teacher. You need to have a teacher. And teaching is not just with the intention of passing on some information. It's not just sending some facts about this book. But it's also through practical demonstration. It's also to the Quran must be part of your life. It is to show how to implement the words of Quran, the actions of into our deeds, into our actions. It is this practical value of knowledge that is important. Like we know, water quenches our thirst. Water will quench our thirst with deeper. But for that, people have to do an act. And what is that act? That act is they need to drink water. We may understand the full chemistry of water. We may know what molecules it's made of, what is the structure of water, but that's not going to quench our thirst. For that, we have to act. We have to drink the glass of water. Lastly, this ayat is telling us is about purification of sin, that this book is supposed to purify us from our false belief, from the false ideology, from the false concepts. It's like water cleans us from the outside. And Quran has to purify our thoughts, purify our actions, both external as well as internal. So who turns away from the deen of Ibrahim but he who makes himself a fool? And certainly we chose him in this world, and in the hereafter he will be among the righteous. وَإِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ قَالَ أَسْلَمْتُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Again, talking of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, it really keeps quoting Hazrat Ibrahim. That's how close Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam is to Allah. And when your Rabb said to him, which means to Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, submit, aslim. And he said, I submit to the Lord of the worlds. Quran tells us why Allah loves Ibrahim alayhi salam so much. Allah asked him to submit, and Ibrahim alayhi salam didn't ask any return question. What is the reason why you are asking me to submit? No question. What to submit? Where to submit? For how long to submit? He said unquestionable obedience. He heard, he obeyed. And when difficulties came to his life, he displayed patience. You know, our issue is that we also, obviously we obey Allah. But when trials come to us, when difficulties come to us, we often become disillusioned. We become disillusioned about this deen. We become disillusioned even about our prayers. I've been asking for such a long time. Nothing is happening. No hope from Allah. That's the problem of modern man. Neither a hope nor a fear. Na Allah se umeed, na Allah ka khauf. And same did Ibrahim instruct to his sons, and so did Yaqub. Oh my sons, surely Allah chose you for this deen. Therefore, do not die unless you are in a state of surrender, unless you are obedient. Were you a witness when death approached Yaqub, when he said to his children, what will you worship after me? And they said, we will worship your God and the God of your fathers, Ibrahim and Ismail and Ishaq, the one God, and to him we shall submit. That was a nation that has passed away. For it there will be what it has earned, and for you there will be what you have earned, and you will not be questioned about what they used to do. So Quran here sums up, this ayat really sums up that nijat and salvation is not being dependent on a group. It is not about teamwork. It is about individual responsibility. What you have earned is for you. What others have earned is for them. And they say, be either Jews or Christians that you may be rightly guided. Say, rather, we will follow the creed of Ibrahim, a Hanif, and he was not of a polytheist. Quran gives the example of Hanif, describing him as a man, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, as a man who turns away from sin, who turns away from dubious beliefs and from worldliness, like Ibrahim. Firm in faith, well-balanced, unquestioned obedience. And say, we believe in Allah and that which was revealed to us and that which has been revealed to Ibrahim and Ismail and Ishaq and the children of Yaqub and which was given to the prophets from thereof. And we do not make distinction between any of them, and to him do we surrender. So if they believe in the like of what you believe in, then they are certainly guided. And if they turn away, then you are only steeped, they are only steeped in defiance. And Allah shall suffice you against them. And he is the all-hearing, all-knowing. Next ayat is such a beautiful ayat. Sibghatallah wa man ahsanu minallahi sibgha wa nahnu lahu abidun. The color of Allah, the hue of Allah. Who can give you a better hue than Allah? And it is he to whom we worship. Quran text tells us, how do we protect ourselves from the fire, you know, fire of hell? How do we really color yourself with the fireproof color? The dye yourself in the color of Allah. This color of Allah must be visible on our face. It must be visible in our prayers. It must be visible in our sacrifice. Everything we should do, it should be only for Allah. It should be in every fiber of our life. And this color should not be so weak that with little difficulty that we encounter, this color goes away, fades down. So all the attributes that Allah has put inside us, the attribute of mercy, the attribute of kindness, being magnanimous, being generous, this must be reflected in our life, in our akhlaq. So do you dispute with us? Do you dispute with us about Allah? He is our Rabb and he is your Rabb, and we shall have our deeds and you shall have your deeds, and to him alone we devote ourselves. Do you say that Ibrahim and Ismail and Ishaq and Yaqub and the tribes were Jews or Christians? Say, is it you who knows better on Allah? And who is the greatest wrongdoer than him who concealed the testimony that is with him from Allah? And Allah is not oblivious of what you do. The last ayat of today, tilka ummatun qad khalat laha ma kasabat wa lakum ma kasabtum wa la tus'aluna amma kanu ya'malun. And that was a nation that has passed. For it there shall be what it has earned, and for you there shall be what you have earned, and you will not be questioned about what they used to do. So no point arguing about people of the past, about what mistakes they did or what mistakes they committed. Quran advises us, worry about your own deeds. At the end, this is your funeral. So barakallahu lana wa lakum fil Quran al-azim wa nafana wa iyyakum bil laikul hakim.